tell you the truth, I don't have any favorites. I love them all, even Spock's brain. You know, which is possibly the worst one we ever made.
Givers of pain and delight.
Spock's brain? Yeah. I think was an interesting idea, the idea that there was a value there. The title tells us that we're on to something that has to do with supposedly something special.
But there is no mind.
There were some really hokey episodes, as I'm sure audiences out there know. My wife Yvonne and I talk a lot about an episode called Spock's Brain. I mean, great idea, no.
Spock's brain controls. It's not possible.
If you did an episode called Einstein's Brain, you would know what you were dealing with. And that was the attempt to do something that had to do with a brain that was special. That Spock had brain power that was unusual, unique, useful, valuable, and somebody would want to steal it.
What would they want with Mr. Spock's brain? What use is it?
Starting from that premise, if I were the producer of the series and Spock came in and somebody, a writer came in and said, we have an idea to do a story about Spock's brain and somebody wants to steal it, I'd pay attention.
Of course. A child could do it.
You know, they go, oh, interesting idea. It becomes a question of execution. Does the story execute well?
What happened? I don't know.
Is it shot well? Does it play well on its feet? I was pretty much, in more ways than one, out of it during the making of that episode.
Not a magician, Spock, just an old country doctor.
Yes, as I always suspected.
I had him pegged as part of the audience, more or less. In other words, I felt that McCoy, he was this very humanistic human being who is actually alive in this bizarre world all around him. And he is being like the audience, like, oh my God, did you see that?
What in blazes is this?
And I kind of became the catalyst in the group, in the trio.
To coin a phrase, fascinating.
And as a result, it turned out that I enjoyed doing the role very much. I had my doubts about it in the beginning.
I don't know how much longer I'm going to be able to stand this. I feel like my neck's in a sling.
Spock, is that you?
Where are you, Spock?
Mr. Spock, where are you?
Once the brain is gone, Spock's kind of a robot, and I had to figure out how to cool down even from cool.
Body? Wait, you have none.
Then what am I? You are a disembodied brain.
And just go kind of limp, numb, dead, and play brainless for a week, which in its own way was kind of a relaxing treat. I realized, going on around me, that some of the stuff seemed kind of silly.
I am Luma. I am Imorg. You are not Imorg. You are not Morg. What are you?
Jim, it's no use.
But there wasn't much of a contribution I could make because I wasn't a participant. I was passive through most of the episode. And not much I could do about what was going on, and what we ended up with was an episode that was kind of a no-brainer.
Brain and brain, what is brain?
Not our best.
Well, now we know how important lasers are, don't we? Everybody laughed about my salt and pepper shakers. Those were lasers. They really weren't salt and pepper shakers. They did look like it.
A lot of them are dead.
The readout on the beds in the sick bay was far off then. Now then, you can go into any hospital and find that type of thing.
This man should be getting stronger.
That's come to pass, and so has the needle that everyone laughed about. The air pressure needle is in use now with diabetics.
I can compensate for the atmosphere and the temperature with this.
It's all getting there. I was reading in the paper this morning that a scientist somewhere has been able to send a photon, as they call it, across the laboratory, and another scientist can catch this transportation and reassemble it in its original form.
Crazy way to travel, spreading a man's molecules all over the universe.
And on the top, it's in the Valley paper today in the L.A. Weekly thing. It says, it's science, but beam us up again, Scotty.